Hello, I'm Norman Swan. I've known fitness expert Michelle Bridges for about 6 years now in my role as medical host of the sometimes controversial reality show Biggest Loser. In that time, I've seen Michelle go from being just one of the trainers to a huge national profile with a highly successful weight loss and fitness business. She's also made headlines with a new relationship and now a baby. What I've discovered about Michelle is that she's really serious about tackling Australia's obesity crisis. And with Michelle, what you see is what you get. This is her story.
Right, so next we've got 15 Whisper at Nova, and then we're heading out to WSFM.
Not even 7 o'clock yet. I've already missed an interview and lost my phone. Woo! It's a good start to the day.
We actually nicknamed this week as the week from hell. And obviously doing that with a newborn is not easy.
We have a publicity itinerary that goes for, Heidi, I noticed that, 20 pages.
When I fell pregnant, I was writing a book, and we knew that the book was going to come out at the beginning of the year, right after I just had a baby. So we were like, ah, how's this all going to work?
Oh, Michelle's schedule is absolutely crazy. Maternity leave has not exactly been maternity leave.
Michelle, how does it make you feel when you help Australians lose a staggering 1.5 million kilos?
I've always felt like in my own way I was making a difference.
The adage is to bite off all you can chew and chew damn hard. And her winning formula is, I don't need anybody, I can do it.
Yes, I signed every single one of these.
In 2015, Michelle made the BRW list of Australia's richest self-made women.
I've been going hell for leather for over a decade now. And it's time for me to have this moment.
It's been a pretty exhausting day. I've been up since 4:45. Got through about 12 or 13 interviews. Asleep.
Axel coming into this world has definitely brought out another side of Michelle. I don't know if at this point she's changing her priorities, but she's definitely asking more questions of herself.
I guess, you know, if others have used the word driven, it's probably pretty accurate, really, like I am. But I don't see that as a negative thing. I love what I do. It's been what I've dreamed of doing since I was a child. So why wouldn't I be driven?
Understand why you feel like you've got to play the joker in this house, why you feel like you've got to play the smart ass in this house. It's earning you no favours.
For the Biggest Loser, I always saw Michelle as a hard ass trainer. She would push her contestants.
You wanted to come in to make a change.
Mm.
We're making one.
But she would give them reason and understanding for her methods.
Our next guest is not only Australia's most influential health and fitness expert, she's now a mum.
Michelle joins us now. A big round of applause.
The level of success and notoriety and fame, I guess, that she's managed to achieve is quite amazing.
Just freaking yeah. Do it.
So hard to believe that a little girl from a very ordinary background...
And where I'm going, you know, what I'm trying to achieve.
And nothing, not one thing handed to her, could achieve and do what she's done in life.
Newcastle, 100 miles north of Sydney, is Australia's seventh largest city.
I was born and bred in Newcastle, Waratah Children's Hospital, just down the road from Kmart. We were definitely a working class family. My parents unfortunately divorced when I was around four. I would definitely say that I was raised by my mum as a single woman.
I was cleaning houses to get some extra income, but it was quite tricky when I had the girls sick. And your boss would say, well, you've got to turn up regardless of what's going on at home.
Michelle sort of used her mother as an example about how things could be and what she could do with her own life.
There was definitely not a lot of money around.
As I only had one uniform for Michelle, it was a case of wash it each night, hang it on a little inside line, get up the next morning and iron it so she had a clean uniform each day. Yeah.
And then when my parents split up, we then moved to Barabar, a few hours northwest of Tamworth.
She had to start a new school and she came home one day very upset because the kids there said she didn't have a father, she'd never had a daddy. But it wasn't that long after that. She comes home, she's class captain.
I was seeing my dad kind of every second weekend or thereabouts. There were arguments, you know, mum and dad would fight. And I do distinctly remember one morning, I could hear them arguing on the phone. I was like, oh my God, you guys.
And so he upset me so much I started to cry. And Michelle was in the bedroom and heard it. And she got out of bed and she snapped the phone off my hand and she said, listen, Dad, piss off.
I look back on that time and I kind of think both my parents were witnessing me becoming that person that's no nonsense and let's just get on with it and I don't have time to have an argument. Come on, just get it together and let's go. We ended up moving several times, which had an impact on my schooling because more often than not, I was the new kid. I'm sure everybody has suffered a little bit of bullying at school. I remember having my school bag completely and utterly ripped to shreds all over the quadrangle, and everybody, you know, found it great sport.
Funny in a sense how there's so many similarities between Michelle and myself at very similar stages in life.
No, it's all right.
I know in my own personal life what it's like to be bullied, what it's like to feel shame. It's part of growing up. I remember one guy in particular, and I used to joke about it, I was his walking, talking punching bag. For whatever reason, he just honed in on me. Maybe he considered me as different, or I was able to do things that he was unable to do, so he would take it out in a physical way on me. I used it as a catalyst to self-improve. In my mind, it was like, I'll prove you wrong.
My sport was definitely a way that I could deal with either being the new kid or being pushed around and being bullied. I could have my time to shine and I could go to a place where I just felt it was almost like I was free, like I was in my zone.
I could see Michelle looking for a direction. Sporting did that for her. She enjoyed that. It gave her a place to be. She wanted to be with sporty people where she could be challenged, self-challenged, and also be challenged by others.
I fell in love with the competition, but I equally fell in love with the commitment and the discipline of the training aspect.
Yay.
So it was when I was at school in Nelson Bay that I could see there were kids on a Wednesday afternoon when we were playing sport that chose not to be a part of it. And I thought they're missing out. So I went to my school mistress and said, I can teach fitness to those kids. This was my first pitch into the business world. And she gave me the green light.
Are you ready to do the workout?
Yeah. And of course, from that point, I thought I was just like the next Jane Fonda. So I took myself off to the local squash court in Nelson Bay and said to them, I can teach fitness classes. And they let me loose on the general public.
She had her little cassette player and she made up the moves. And the first class, she got about four or five people. And then the next class, she had a few more.
So I guess it was around those years of 14, 15, 16 that I realised I'd found my passion. I'd found something that just made me feel, this is what I want to do the rest of my life. A big turning point for me, something quite dramatic in my life happened when I was 18. We moved to Taree.
I took Michelle and I drove into Taree to do some shopping. And she said to me, all right, Mum, well, I'll go looking for a job.
I was actually just looking for a part-time job. And I went in for, you know, an off-the-cuff interview at a restaurant. And the next thing I know, the guy was attacking me and basically trying to rape me. And in my head, I thought, this is just not going to happen. This is not going to happen. Like, this is not my story. I absolutely fought back with everything that I had. I got out. I ran all the way to the police station.
She really amazed me, you know. I mean, most young girls would be just a crying wreck, and I probably would have been. But, no, she was strong and determined, and she said, and Mum, he wasn't getting my handbag either. I grabbed that as well.
So it ended up that the man went to prison. I saw a psychologist. And then in the end, I realised I can't carry this thing around because if I do, it means that he still has control. So I had to at some point let it go. I moved out at 18 and had this job in a bank. Did I hate the job? Yeah, I hated it. So I went back, started teaching classes on the weekends. Or in the evenings, even got into bodybuilding.
I thought, I think you can do a little better than that look. Stay in fitness, sure, but maybe not that type of fitness, that real muscly look.
I guess it was around the age of 26 that I knew it was time for me to get serious.
Michelle packed up her sports girl Holden Barina with everything that she owned, and she had a little bit of money in the bank, and drove to Sydney with a goal to set up her career.
My ambition, my burning desire was to really become a part of the fitness industry and have it as a full-time career.
I had a health club in Balmain. Michelle, at that stage, she was hungry. She was very ambitious. As a fitness instructor, she was phenomenal. I thought, whoa, this girl has got some stuff going on. And I saw her and I said, wow, your legs look amazing. And she told me some years afterwards that the moment I said that, she instantly compartmentalised me into dickhead. Well, a bit of romance started to happen, I guess, in sort of 99. We got married in 2003.
Up tall, let's do it. All right, big shoulder roll.
A big milestone in my career was becoming a trainer for one of the most successful companies in the world when it comes to exercise programming.
All right, halfway down the leg, dead row, halfway.
And they sent me all over Australia And then they started sending me global.
It should be harder. Here, it should be.
The moment she got herself in a position of notoriety within her own industry, she was looking to expand that outside because she had this vision of getting Australia moving.
I could see that my industry, the fitness industry, wasn't making a dent in this obesity epidemic that was coming. I need to get this message out to people who haven't heard it before.
If you find yourself snacking on a bit of junk food and for...
And that's when I sort of thought maybe television is an opportunity to sort of get that message out.
Morning fitness consultant Michelle Bridges. Michelle, how are you?
Good morning, I'm very well.
And Kerry Ann Kennelly was one of the participants in one of my classes. So I chased her around the gym with my idea ad nauseam.
She knew I had the program on and said, you know, I'd like to do fitness. And I said, okay, fitness doesn't always work on television.
You can exercise anytime, anywhere.
But she was ambitious, which is a quality I particularly liked. Michelle wanted to be a star. Michelle got fitness.
Go!
That was her expertise. She knew how to deliver it, and that made her a star.
We got some big Aussies up there.
Yeah.
My name is Bob Harper.
In 2005, when The Biggest Loser first screened in Australia, two American trainers,
California-based,
we sat down to watch it, and within the first few minutes, she said, I can do that job.
Are you a member of my red team?
She was almost desperate to get that show. She just felt so strongly that she was able to do that.
10 more!
Because I knew I could damn well do it good.
No, Michelle wanted... She wanted Biggest Loser bad.
My name is Michelle Bridges. I'm a personal trainer and I've been in the industry for about 18 years.
Biggest Loser is about basically taking on contestants who are obese, morbidly obese, and working with them 24/7 to... not just lose the weight, but understand their lifestyles and what's led them to be in the situation that they're in right now.
How dare she, like, have to feel that she has to humiliate me to work harder?
Now you can start getting angry about those Mars bars, honey.
I think when they first cast for that show, they were looking for someone who was a bit of a ball breaker. There's no doubt about that.
Get him up. If you want to go in there and go hard with food, fine. Here's your training session to match it.
Here to go.
When they start to shed all that extra and excess baggage, then suddenly their self-belief rises and this person that's always been there has a moment or a time to shine. And that, for me, is really why I do it.
And I've never been able to do a chin-up in my life and somehow I pulled out 10.
Go, Courtney. 10, good job. And the crowd is cheering.
We have all sorts of critics that will say you're putting these people up to be insulted or laughed at or made the butt of a joke. I think it might be seen that I have this agenda on, you know, people who are overweight or people who are deemed fat. Honestly, if you are happy where you are, genuinely, more power to you. But I can tell you now, I'm yet to have met someone who is morbidly obese and happy.
I guess you guys are wondering why I'm here. So I am now officially your trainer.
I was 158.6 kilos. I knew she was very tough.
Come on, boys, dig in now. Let's go. Last chance training.
Our first training session with Michelle, I didn't think I was going to make it through. She pushed us mentally as well.
He's going to keep up momentum, my friend.
I think she was very empathetic to us. She'd come in on the weekends in her own time to help train all the contestants.
That's why you're doing this.
Yeah, that's why I'm doing this. Absolutely.
We've all lost a tremendous amount of weight. I've lost 59 kilos. I've managed to keep it off.
All right, you know what to do, yeah? Crunches. Ice skaters.
I guess the notoriety was increasing. I could see there was an opportunity there. a business opportunity for an inspirational female role model.
Say that the clothing line that I now produce is affordable and goes up to size 26.
Kind of just grew and grew.
So many people would come to Michelle and say to her, oh, can you train me? But of course it was completely unscalable and unmanageable. The idea of doing something online was a really critical one. And it was an incredible success from the very beginning.
Hi, I'm Michelle Bridges. I hope to transform as many lives as possible to train, to educate and to inspire.
For every year, BRW publishes a list of the wealthiest self-made women in Australia. And with the rising profile of Michelle Bridges, we thought she was worth having a look at. And in 2015, she made the cut, 29th richest self-made lady in Australia. Wealth we estimate of about $53 million.
I mean, it wasn't true, but it damaged us. It damaged Michelle's reputation. I think people then started looking at Michelle as just being someone who was a money-making machine.
And your beautiful family.
So the feedback we've been getting on sales is really strong. We don't know yet whether we're a bestseller, but I believe...
I look around and think, holy moly, how did this really all happen? So there's a lot of people in my industry who applaud what I've done, and there's a few in there that look at me and go, how? You know, but that's okay.
What's the point?
Sleeping is overrated. Let's be honest. Sleeping is overrated.
Her and Bill were a great partnership. I don't think children were on the table at the time. The career and the business and making a difference was the subject and the issue.
It was everywhere. It was omnipresent. And inevitably, our relationship was suffering from it. And really, in hindsight, we probably both chose the business over the relationship. Maybe that was the baby that we didn't have.
If you cast your mind back...
We both ended up feeling like we were living with our business partners.
Well, we've got a great energy here.
Bill and I spoke about it a good 18 months before I decided finally to separate.
You know, that was a very difficult time. I felt that I didn't want to leave the relationship. I didn't want it to end. But Michelle had sort of, for her she wasn't in the same space.
My name's Steve Willis. I'm an ex-army commando.
Right, place your bags down in front of you.
When I first met him, he was pretty much straight out of the army, virtually. So he was very intense back then, and I remember thinking, who is this guy?
For a long time, making season after season of The Biggest Loser, we were just friends. It was more of a communication connection that I think drew us together in that sense, rather than anything physical. The thing about Michelle that got my attention was her willingness to listen, and you could sit for minutes, you know, hours and just talk, and she would be just like a sounding board.
We both came together at a time where we were both pretty raw and in a place of, wow, what's happening to our relationships? Steve has three beautiful children. They're in my life and I'm in theirs.
Gosh, you know, when it was identified that Michelle and I were in a relationship, it was the paparazzi and just stories.
And we were trying to get to know each other, just go out on a date. And we'd have cameras everywhere, which was pretty full on.
I understand how the whole media thing works, but I truly believe that there could be a lot more respect shown when it comes to, you know, my children.
The gossip stuff is fodder. She is now a nationally known person, which means Her life, for good, bad or ugly, is always going to be out there.
And of course, a special congratulations to Michelle and Commando with your baby on the way. Michelle and I have had conversations around parenthood and whether she would ever become a parent.
That's going to be one healthy baby.
Or if she'd let it go too long, was the time right, how would a child fit in the mix of her business?
It absolutely just felt right. For the first time in my 44 years, it absolutely felt right. I was being interviewed by a magazine and I did say that, you know, I feel like all my years of looking after myself and looking after my health has definitely been a contributing factor in me allowing my, you know, in falling pregnant at 44. And you know, I got myself in a fairly large amount of hot water by saying that. So then, of course, I copped a fairly large amount of heat because I was exercising while I was pregnant.
Weight loss queen Michelle Bridges has been slammed over her latest training regime.
Then it was another, I guess, onslaught of heat that came about because of my training after Axel was born.
Which includes a half-hour jog and 24 minutes of walking just weeks after giving birth to son Axel.
But I was going at the right level for me, myself, a person who has been training since she was 14. There is absolutely no way that I ever put myself or my child in any kind of danger by doing something ridiculous.
It never entered my head that she would have a baby. It just didn't. By that stage, by 40 at least, I thought, no, no. She's a career girl.
You gonna help me, Pad?
He's smiling now, making little noises and carrying on. That's amazing.
Put his pants on in front of the camera.
Hey.
Having a child has just been the best thing I think I've ever done, and I've done a lot. You start thinking about family and, you know, family members and, you know, what's happened in the past. I don't really have a relationship with my dad. I haven't really had one with him for, gosh, some years. Hey. My dad would now know that I've had a baby and that he's got a grandson. So I think, gosh, you know, should I introduce Axel to him? And that probably would be a really nice thing to do. Just, I don't know how that one will roll. I've thought about it. That's about as far as I've got. Having Axel has really made me think more about how I can use what I've learned about health and fitness to make life better for kids like him. Potentially getting out there and putting some truth and hard-hitting messages around the junk food industry and the sugar industry. And the truth of the matter is they sell crap food and make people sick. And that makes me angry. I'd like to tackle the junk food industry the way that the tobacco industry was tackled 50-odd years ago. We're now seeing children that potentially have a lifespan shorter than their parents. Never before have we ever seen that. Globally, we're now seeing it. Why? I'd like to get out there and start fighting the fight for others who can't fight the fight.
I think she really wants to put some more time into, you know, Axel and just watching that, you know, mother you know, child relationship flourish in that sense. Maybe take the foot off the pedal a little bit.
Yeah, I slowed down a bit. My version of slowing down. It's easy for me to say no to things now because, you know, he is, without a doubt, the most important thing. And it'll work out. It'll just, we'll make it work.
Woken up halfway through the session and got mummy out of it.